Good day and welcome to today's sermon. My name is Pastor Lawrence. It's always wonderful to be back with you. And today we're talking about a broken heart. Now, let me start with a few examples. You know, in life, things happen and give us broken hearts. You know, who can remember your first love? You know, you saw this person, you fell in love, you loved this person. And then the next moment, this person doesn't love you. It's just a one-way love. And we all know what that broken heart is. I believe we all do. And then maybe when you had a bicycle, maybe when your bicycle broke down, you know, I remember the day my sister and I was driving back from school, and she had a little accident and she fell down from a bicycle and she was crying. And I thought, you know, she got hurt or it is about her bike that was broken. But I said, hey, are you okay? And she's crying. I said, why are you crying? And she had a little packet of Ghostbusters chips. I don't know if you remember back in the days in my country, we had this, you know, like this packet of chips, a snack. And the snack went open. And she said, because my snack was open. I lost my snack. I mean, she just, you know, downhill, almost crashed into the river. And she was crying about her snack. But she was brokenhearted about her snack. And then, you know, also maybe when you maybe scratched your first car or bumped your first car, you know, I don't know if that happened to you, but I remember the day that I was, you know, I think I had to pull my dad's Audi. We had an Audi out of the garden, and I felt this Audi doesn't want to go anymore. I was still in school. And then I saw the gate, you know, was pressing into the Audi, you know, that feeling. And, you know, people will disappoint you and break your heart. You know, this week I'm supposed to move here next week from Sejong. So we all almost finished moving to Jinju. And I got a new teacher and he signed the contract. My boss was ready. He got a new house. And then just a few days ago, he canceled because he got a better deal. So I was kind of not heartbroken, but I was stressed because of the situation. And then my boss was heartbroken. You know, he came to me like, why did you introduce this man? And, you know, on and on. And I was, I was worried about that. But things happen, you know, people disappoint you. And when I prayed about this situation, God just said, turn the other cheek. You know, we want to fight back and we want to, yeah, but you know, but God says, turn the other cheek. And even when my boss became so angry and said, I don't trust you anymore. Why do you introduce these people? They just quit. You're such a bad guy. You know, I just like, wow, my goodness. You know, it's my friend who did this, you know, and I wanted to hit back, you know, and say a few not so kind words back to him. And I said, God, what must I do? And God told me, turn the other cheek. I'm like, oh my God, I don't want to turn the other cheek. The other way, the Bible also says, be good to your enemies. And it will be like throwing coals on their head. And I was like, yes, God, I want to throw that coals today on my boss' head. And God said, be good. So, yeah, you know, my boss got married yesterday. So I'm going to buy him a very nice wedding gift and say, pour some coals on his head. That's not what I want to do, but that's what the Bible says. We should be good to others. But so yeah, I had a little broken heart there. And then, you know, also life can disappoint you. You know, sometimes things just go wrong. Things just go the other way, you know, and your heart gets broken. These things happen. I remember when in South Africa, I lost everything. I've told the story before. I lost my business. I lost my income. The bank was calling me every day, pay, and I couldn't pay my car. They wanted to take my car back. And then I prayed, and I remember that day when somehow Freddie's mom told me that he was here in Korea as a teacher. And that day when I lost everything and I prayed and said, God, what do I do now? Long story short, I heard about Freddie here in Korea. I applied for the job. I got it. I think 2 or 3 weeks later, I was on my way to South Korea and I've been here 15 years. And that is just God will make a way. You know, at that stage, my heart was broken. My business failed, a lot of things. But God made a way. And when these things happen, when God makes a way like that, now when other things happen, like the boss and that, you just smile. You just go through this with peace. It's not easy, but we know that God will make a way. And God works in ways we cannot see. You know, Freddie was here working, preparing the way. Maybe God was using my cousin Freddie to prepare a way for me. I didn't even knew about Korea. You know, when I was young, I knew about the other Asian countries, but I never knew about Korea. And I would never have it another way. You know, I'm so happy to be here, and I've been here for many years. And then we have our spouses. For those that are married, you know, we know our spouses can break our hearts. You know, things can go wrong there also. Then the other cheek, your kids can break your heart. I think how many times have I broken my parents' heart, you know, and maybe you also and your kids. But if you're a parent, keep on praying. I've told the story before. One of the pastors that started our church in South Africa, he was breaking his mom's heart every day. This like maybe 100 years ago, 3 or 4 generations, they had these big discos. That was the days of discos and live bands, you know, and he was playing in the band and he was going to these dances and wild parties every night on his horse. And as he was getting ready, his mom was going to say, okay, my son. Well, she said, please don't go. But he said, I'm going anyways. She said, okay, you go. I'll be praying for you. And as he got dressed up, his mom went to his inner room and started praying for him. And he could hear her praying. And this is like, stupid mom. Went, broke her heart, went to these wild parties every night, came back to find her still on her knees praying for him. This is like, it went on for months. I don't know how long. And one day he's like, okay, mom, I'm going to the party. Okay, I'm going to pray for you. Don't worry. And as he was driving, lightning struck right next to him. And he heard a voice told him, if that lightning struck you, would you be in heaven or hell right now? And he jumped off his horse and he repented. And he said, God, I'm sorry. And when he went back home, his mom was still praying. So God worked in ways that his mom couldn't see. And he repented from that. And he became one of the founder pastors of our church back in South Africa. So yeah, that's a mom's prayer. So yes, your family can also break your heart. These things happen. You know, broken hearts come in all shapes and sizes. You know, when I go to the store and there is no kimbap, my heart is broken. Because I love kimbap, you know, that's a little thing. But then you have bigger things like that I just taught. You know, many Bible characters also experience broken hearts. So I'm not here to tell you today this sunshine and roses and clouds and flowers. No, life is not like that. I wish it could be. But, you know, life sometimes takes us through broken hearts. But there's a way. God always makes a way. You know, if you think about Jacob, his heart was broken when they told him Joseph was killed. You know, Jacob was there. He had a few sons. He had also Joseph. The sons, we know the story. If you don't know, they threw him in a pit and they went home, told his father he died. And his father believed that. And his heart was broken. And the Bible said he didn't even eat. He just wanted to die because he loved the son so much. I think it was his last born. And in the meantime, Joseph was on the camels on the way to Egypt. You know, he went to Egypt. As we know, he became Potiphar's servant. He went to jail. He became king. His father was back home, not knowing that God was making a way. Because while his father thought the son is dead, maybe, you know what, who knows what, God was preparing a way. Joseph was getting all that food ready and prepared for that great severe famine that would hit that country. And many years later, when his brothers went there, Joseph said, what you meant for bad, God meant for good. And I'm the king of Egypt. And so they bring his father, the whole family, they all had food and they didn't die. My goodness, God works in ways we cannot see. Just think his father never knew what was happening behind the scenes. And I want to encourage you today, exactly like the story, is your heart broken? Do you feel sad? Is there something worrying you today? Then maybe you're a Jacob. Maybe you just don't know. Maybe one day you will see, wow, God's been working all these years. And I know God is working. Job also had a broken heart. Just remember about, just think about losing everything. I've had those days two times in my life. The day that I lost my company, not my company, it was, I was working for a company, having my own company. I was selling life insurance. So that was it. So I remember the day the boss called me in and said, do you have something else planned for your life? And I'm like, yeah, well, and he said, well, you're fired. And in one day, I lost my job. I lost my house. I went back to my parents' house. Luckily, they had a place for me to stay and they took care of me. And then the second time here in South Korea, when I lost also my house, my job, everything in one day. But you know, when these things happen, you feel like everybody is gone and it's just me and God. And I just like, well, God, it's just you that I have left. I will just focus on you now. And that's the secret. This last time when this happened, I went home, slept on my sister's floor, wondering what's next, and I got married. So long story short, God was getting me out of, you know, Sangju to go back home to meet my wife, to get married, to come back to Sejong, and I've been living there for 7 years. I could never imagine that God would take me from losing everything like a job to giving me more than you can imagine. But that was a broken heart time. And then Jesus' heart was broken. You know, when Peter denied him, just imagine walking with Jesus so many, many years. And then, you know, your disciples, you're teaching them, you're feeding the thousands, you're raising the dead, you're doing all these miracles. And in the time that you are going to be killed and crucified, he swear he doesn't know God. The Bible said he used bad language. I don't know him. I don't know Jesus. You know, Jesus looked at him and the crow and the rooster crowed 3 times. Jesus' heart was broken, I think, in that stage. And then today, my poor brother David. David's heart was broken by his own hand. So sometimes we broke our own hearts. Sometimes we do things that just doesn't has the best of results. And that is what we're going to be focusing on today, and I think maybe into next time. So David's heart was broken because of his own doing. You know, sometimes we break our own hearts. Sometimes we go in ways that God don't want us to go. You know, and if your heart gets broken, well, God is amazing. God always let it work for the good. You know, we have that insurance that everything works for the good. Imagine I'm selling you something today. Say, listen, no matter what you do, I will pay for it. If you crash your car, I will fix it. If you burn down your house, I will fix it. Everything you do, I will make it good. So just go ahead and do whatever. I will make it good. I think you will all buy my insurance right now. And that is the insurance you have as a Christian. The Bible says everything works for the good. Everything works for the good. Well, David was the second king of Israel, and he was chosen by God as a shepherd boy. You know, God saw David there where he was behind the sheep, taking care of the sheep. And he had a lot of courage. You know, he protected his flock from the lions and the bears. The Bible said he killed lions and bears. Brothers and sisters, have you seen a lion? Have you been close to a lion? I don't know if you've been, but in South Africa, we know lions. You know, we have one of the biggest parks in the whole world. I don't know if it's in the world, but definitely the size of Korea, I've heard, our safari. And we have real lions there, and they walk around wild, and we go and stay in camps. But a few hundred times, we've parked next to those lions, and their eyes are yellow, you know, and they look really hungry and dangerous. And a little boy killing a lion, that is not by his power, that's by God's power. I also have a friend. He is a lion farmer, and he has 500 lions on his farm. And I've heard stories where this lion, sometimes my other friend that's working for him, he was attacked by one of the lions. But Uncle Ben is a big guy. He jumped on the lion and pulled him from that guy. So I know one person who did that. So he's a big guy. I know Uncle Ben. You also know Uncle Ben. But this little poor boy, I'm taking care of his sheep, fighting off lions and bears. This was David. And then this little boy stood up against Goliath. You know, Goliath was this big giant who wanted to kill the Israelites. And he said, I will go and kill him, or fight him at least. And he went there, and we know the story. David won that battle with five rocks, you know. And then he became the greatest king. And, you know, he was the only man ever that God said, a man after God's own heart. Wow, how amazing. I think God saw little David next to the river, writing some of those psalms, praying, worshiping, taking care of his sheep, trusting God to keep his sheep, his flock alive from the bears and the lions. And God said, oh my goodness, he's a man after my heart. And then David's heart was broken. You know, when they had to pick a king, his father invited all the sons to be, you know, the prophet said, one of your sons must be the king. He didn't even invite David. Just imagine that. You know, they're looking for the next king. Your father don't even think you are worthy to be at this event. But he got through all of that. There was a problem. And here, the story takes a turn. David was a man. Okay, you will get that. David was a man. One night he couldn't sleep, and he went for a walk on his roof in his cell, and he saw a woman taking a bath. And so he inquired about this woman called Bathsheba, and she was married to one of his soldiers. So he sent for her because he really started to love her too much. So she conceived that night, and David tried to cover up his sin. He called for her husband from the battle. Her husband was on the battlefield. So he called for her and said, okay, please, you know, take some break. Please spend some time with your wife, because he wanted to this baby that was conceived to look like Ur's baby. So a nice cover up. You know, yes, big David, man of God, man after God's own heart, all these things. Just one night he saw this woman, felt for her, or his own sin broke his own heart. He went to the next step. So he called her husband to come back, but her husband said, I will not go to my wife's house because we are in battle. He was such a pure guy that he said, I will not do this. So then David gave him a letter. Just imagine you have a letter that you need to give to the boss of the army. What's written in that letter? It was written there, withdraw from Oren in the heat of the battle, that he may be killed. So the very letter that David sent to the ruler was that. Just imagine that guy opened the letter and like, okay, thank you for the letter, you know, but just imagine that he had to put this guy in the front of the armies, and when they attack, they withdraw and he must be killed. And the plan worked perfectly. I mean, the guy was killed, David's sin was carried up, the whole thing. But there was a problem. Someone else was watching, and this was God. You know, God sees where we don't see. God sees everything. You know, just think about that. When you live in sin, when you live your sinful life, your secret things, we all know, God sees that. God even saw David's plan. God saw this whole story. God's man, how he fell for this lady, how this all happened. So in the end, David married Bathsheba. And now the story starts with Nathan. So Nathan was a prophet. He was a prophet there. Now just imagine you had this whole affair. There was a baby conceived. You covered up nicely. You know, all evidences were killed and wiped out. And here Nathan comes and say, hey, brother David, I've got a story. I'm going to tell you a nice little story. Do you want to hear a story? And you know, we all love stories, you know. So in 2 Samuel 12, verse 1 to 17, and the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, Brother David, do you want to hear a story? And Brother David said, yes. Okay, that's my own words. Now listen to this beautiful story. There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up. So the story starts with the rich man with all these riches and flocks and herds and cattle. On the other side, there was this little poor man with one lamb, with one little lamb. And it grew up together with him and with his children. How cute it is. This little lamb, you know, grew up with the man, you know, and the children, and with his children, and he did eat of his own meat. Interesting. The lamb eat of its own meat and drank of its own cup. What an interesting story. Lamb don't eat meat or drink from a cup, but you know, it's like a little fairy tale. He did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom. So this little lamb, you know, the story went, the poor man took care of this lamb, gave him his own meat, drink from his own cup. I'm reading from the Bible, okay? I'm just making it like sound like a story. And lay in his own bosom and was unto him as a daughter. My goodness. So I think David just sat there like, wow, this is a lovely story, you know, story time, bedtime stories. I just paused. Just a few days ago, I walked down the street and there was a little pig, a piglet in a cage just down the street. And the thing was the cutest piglet, you know. It was tame. I could rub its back and it went oi, oi, oi. And when I touch it, it tries to lick my finger. It was the cutest thing. And it was for sale. And I said, Michelle, can we buy this pig? I really want to buy this little pet pig. Exactly like this man in the story. And she said, no, you know, so you can be happy. Otherwise, you would hear pigs screaming. But, you know, pigs here at my little house, I think main pastor would not be happy. But it's the same thing. And was unto him as a daughter. So he really loved this little pig. Beautiful story. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wavering man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. So the rich guy decided, you know, I've got a visitor, so I'm not going to take one of my own. I'm going to take the poor man's little sheep, slaughter it, cook it, and give it to my friend. This is what happened. What a drama. I mean, the story starts so lovely, but every story has a drama. So this was the drama. I think, well, let's see, David was distressed by the story, but took the poor man's lamb, and David's anger was greatly kindled against that man. So when David listened to the story, he's like, what in the world? You mean you get this, in case I bought that little piglet and raised the piglet and somebody take it and cook it for somebody else. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord live. Wow, as God live, the man that have done this thing should surely die. David got so angry, he said, as God is alive, the man who did this, he must die immediately. And he shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and because he had no pity. Wow, I think David was like, my goodness, you know, this is a terrible drama. And Nathan said to David, not well done or nicely or thank you for listening to my story. He said, thou art this man. You are the guy in the story. just imagine that. Nathan proceeded to announce God's judgment and David in regards to his sin. Exactly this thing. God saw all that David did and he told this all to Nathan. Wow, what a drama. What a drama. David broke his own heart. David broke his own heart by his own things, by his own mishaps. Samuel 2, verse 12, verse 13, and David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said unto David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin, thou shalt not die. So immediately David repented. He said, oh, I think he was so shocked. I think he didn't knew God knew. He didn't knew Nathan knew. But he said, I've sinned. His first words was, I've sinned. And he said, the Lord hath put away thy sin. This is even before Jesus. You know, now we sin on a daily basis, multiple times. And God's grace, the blood of Jesus, doesn't cover it. It takes it away. It wipes it away as far as the east is from the west. But David lived before Jesus. But even in this time, the Bible says that God has put away his sin, put away the sin already. And God said, you shall not die. Though David broke his own heart. You know, how do we know that? Well, in Psalm 51, we'll do Psalm 51 next week. I'll see, we are out of time here. But from next week, I will focus on Psalm 51, how David actually handled this whole situation. And if you want to hear the rest of this story, please come back next time. Let's pray. Father, thank you today that we could talk about this story. And Lord, we've all sinned. Lord, we've all did these things that David did, Lord, many times on a daily basis, Father. But thank you, Lord, that today I just pray for us, Lord, to help us to repent. Help us to say, please forgive me, I'm sorry. And thank you, Lord, we have Jesus. Thank you, Lord, we have your blood, Lord, that was shed on the cross. And thank you today with boldness, we can come to your throne, Lord, as pure as white, as clean as snow, Lord, because you've washed us with the blood of the Lamb. And Lord, we've accepted that. And thank you, Father, that we have that grace. We have that love of Jesus in our life. And we pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.